First of all, I would like to thank IOA PGT team program headed by Rajagopalan sir for giving me this opportunity to share one case which I have seen recently. Unfortunately, I couldn't bring the child again to take necessary photographs because the child didn't come due to the COVID problems in Kerala. So the presenting complaint was a four-year-old boy who came with limping since childhood and toe walking for the past 1 year. History of the presenting complaint, he started walking at the age of 15 months. Limping was on the left side. There was no pain. There was no constitutional symptoms. And initially, recently he started toe walking. Initially it was occasional, but now it has become constant. The limping is getting worse. The child is able to run, child is able to walk normally, is able to squat, and is able to sit cross-legged. If you look at the past history, it was the first child in the family, normal term delivery, the birth weight was 3 kg, the prenatal, natal, and postnatal history was normal, motor milestones were normal, no history of neonatal ICU admission, no history suggestive of neonatal sepsis, started walking at 15 months, and there was no similar illness in the family. So there was no history suggestive of a neurodevelopmental disorder in this child, and there was no history suggestive of neonatal sepsis. So the facies of the child was normal. The height was 98 centimeters within normal limits. Weight was 12 kg and again within acceptable limits. Upper segment, lower segment ratio was normal and no clinical evidence of rickets or bone dysplasia. So there was no head to foot examination did not show any evidence of rickets like box shaped skull or dental caries or thickening of the metaphysis, rickety rosary, Harrison sulcus or deformities in the lower limb. There was no evidence of any disproportionate dwarfism, deformities, suggestive of bone dysplasia. Systemic examination was within normal limits. So initially it was a girl actually, it was not a boy. So this is the gait of that girl. See her walking. You concentrate on the left foot. The child walks on the toes, okay? The child is able to walk plantigrade, but she prefers to walk on the toes. When she walks plantigrade, it looks like a short-limbed gait with a little bit lurch towards that side also. Not only dipping, but there is some lurching also. On inspection, the left lower limb was slightly more externally rotated compared to the right side. Anterior superior leg spine was at the same level. There was no visible swelling over the past triangle, no wasting of the thigh muscles, and patella and medial malleolus were at a higher level. So there appeared to be shortening of the left lower limb, and the left lower limb was externally rotated. On inspection, there was no increase in the lumbar lordosis, and the trochanter was at a higher level. There is no gluteal muscle wasting. On palpation, the anterior superior leg spine was palpated to be at the same level. No anterior joint line tenderness or swelling. Vascular sign was negative. The pulse was equally felt on both sides. The trochanter was elevated, but it is not thickened. It is not tender. There was no thickening or tenderness in the upper femur. There was no palpable mass in the gluteal region. So the line, the red line is the level of the anterior superior leg spine, and here is the level of the trochanter. So the left trochanter was at a higher level and the anterior superior iliac spine was at the same level. Then we go into the movements, found that there was abduction and internal rotation were restricted, and there was exaggeration of adduction and external rotation. So this is the abduction on the normal side, and this is the abduction on the affected side. You see that on the left side, the abduction was restricted. We look at the adduction, it is restricted on the right, it is less on the right side, and it is exaggerated on the left side. So there is restriction, there is a restriction of abduction and exaggeration of adduction. If you look at the rotation, inflection, you find that the internal rotation was restricted on the left side, and the external rotation, you see, is exaggerated on the left side. Compared to the right side, the external rotation was exaggerated. When you look at the measurements, there was an apparent shortening of 3 centimeters. There was a true shortening is the same because the anterior superior iliac spine was at the same level. And drawing the Bryant's triangle, we found that it is in the supratrochanteric level. There was no thymus in VST. So this is just to show the shortening. Trendelenburg sign, there are some problem when the child is less than 5 years old, but this child was able to stand. But with that amount of shortening, unless you correct the shortening, you will not be able to do it properly. This is another child with the same diagnosis, which I saw a couple of months back, showing a positive Trendelenburg. Telescopy was negative. The Shoemaker's line, the Nelaton's line, a Boris mitochondric line, and Nelaton's line show that the line was crossing the tip of the trochanter on the left side. Shoemaker's line shows that it was converging on the opposite side below the umbilicus. The bitrochanteric test was negative. The opposite hip was normal. The sacroiliac joint was normal. The knee joint was normal. And the spine, it is interesting to know that the scoliosis with the convexity to the right was seen when the child was standing plantigrade, but it disappeared on tiptoe standing, because the child is compensating for the shortening by standing on the tiptoe. So in summary, this four-year-old girl, limping since childhood and now having toe walk on the left side, no fixed deformities, no palpable mass in the gluteal region, the vascular sign of NARATH was negative, limitation of abduction and internal rotation, increased adduction and external rotation, shortening of 3 centimeters at the supratrochanteric level, telescopy was negative, and the Trendelenburg was supposed to be positive. So these were the findings in that four-year-old girl, which I saw recently. And the diagnosis was Coxa-Vara. Then immediately the examiner will ask you, what are your points in favor of Coxa-Vara? The points in favor of Coxa-Vara are: 1, there is shortening. 2, that shortening is at the supratrochanteric level. The elevated trochanter is there. There is limitation of abduction and internal rotation. There is exaggeration of adduction and external rotation. And a positive Trendelenburg test was there. With these findings, you think that it is Coxa-Vara. Then next is the pathological diagnosis. The common causes of Coxa-Vara are: 1 is a congenital Coxa-Vara, where it is associated with a proximal focal femoral deficiency, and it is a subtrochanteric type of Coxa-Vara, and there is no gross shortening in the femoral segment as such, so it is unlikely to be a congenital Coxa-Vara. Developmental Coxa-Vara, of course, is a possibility, because it was noted after the age of 1 when the child started walking, and it is progressively increasing. Third type is the metabolic type, that is rickets. There was no evidence of rickets. Many syndromes are associated with Coxa-Vara, but there is no evidence of any bone dysplasia in this particular case. Then another cause is the infection. Infection, septic arthritis can produce it in two different ways. That is, choice type 2 and type 3 can produce it. In type 2, it is due to a physeal involvement, and type 3, it is due to a physeal slip. But here again, there was no evidence suggestive of infective arthritis of infancy. So the other differential diagnosis that has to be considered are one, DDH. Why it is not DDH? It is because there is no evidence to show that the hip is not inside the joint, because the vascular sign of Neirath is negative. And it is not, you are not able to palpate the head outside the joint, that is in the gluteal region. Therefore, the hip is inside the acetabulum, and therefore there is no evidence of DDH. Then secular septic arthritis, I have already said Coxa-Vara. The other secular is the type 4 CHOI, where there is a partial destruction or a complete destruction of the femoral head. In partial destruction of the femoral head, again, there will be a history of neonatal sepsis, and telescopy may not be grossly positive, but to some extent, there will be some yielding will be there. And the fourth one is complete destruction of the femoral head, but Frank's pseudarthrosis, where you find that it will be grossly positive. The telescopy test will be grossly positive. So, considering all the differential diagnosis, we came to the conclusion that it is probably a developmental Coxa-Vara. Then the examiner will ask you, what investigation will you do to confirm the diagnosis? Of course, you need an X-ray, and this is the X-ray. And this X-ray again is typical, because you can see there is a gap in the femoral neck here, and there is a triangular fragment that is seen here. This is what is called as the Fairbanks triangle, Fairbanks triangle, described by Fairbanks in early 1920s. So it is due to a defect in the endochondral ossification that is occurring in the neck. So the Coxa-Vara is there because the neck shaft angle is less than 120 degrees. And this is what is called as the Hilgen-Rinner's epiphyseal angle. This is extremely important to assess the prognosis. So this is the Hilgen-Rinner's line, and the other is the epiphyseal line. If it is below 30 degrees, that there is no evidence of progression. The normal angle is around 16 degrees. And here you find that it is 60 degrees. So this Coxa-Vara is likely to progress. So these are the usual things. Then we will go into the treatment part. So I'll take another 10 minutes to tell you something regarding Coxa-Vara, because there is an important topic for the students. The first thing is, what is Coxa-Vara? It is a reduction in the neck shaft angle below 120 degrees. Coxa valga is one where the neck shaft angle is more than 135 degrees. The normal is between 120 to 135 degrees. What are the types of Coxa-Vara? It is a congenital Coxa-Vara, developmental Coxa-Vara, dysplastic Coxa-Vara, and acute types of Coxa-Vara like trauma, sepsis, Perthes, metabolic, and slipped capital femoral epiphysis. These are some of the cases of Coxa-Vara which I have seen recently. The first one is a case of osteogenesis imperfecta with bilateral Shepherd croup deformity, which is classically seen in fibrous dysplasia, producing Coxa-Vara. This is a case of renal rickets, renal tubular acidosis, producing Coxa-Vara deformity. This was a case of septic arthritis with partial destruction of the femoral head, producing Coxa-Vara. Slipped capital femoral epiphysis producing Coxa-Vara. Here was a solitary bone cyst which fractured and healed in a varus position. And finally, this is a case of Perthes disease producing Coxa-Vara. So congenital Coxa-Vara is usually present at birth, and it is associated with short femur, PFFD, or fibular hemimelia. Developmental Coxa-Vara is a clinical entity characterized by postnatal presentation of Coxa-Vara with characteristic radiological findings. So what are the features of congenital Coxa-Vara? Present at birth with, you can see the short femur associated with the deformities like conditions like PFFD, commonly unilateral, present with auto-engage due to femoral retroversion and varying degrees of shortening of the limb. This is the child I am following up. Now the child is around 5 years, and we are waiting for a lengthening of the femur with congenital Coxa-Vara. You see the here the Coxa-Vara is in the subtrochanteric level. A congenital Coxa-Vara usually occurs in the subtrochanteric level. developmental Coxavara, previously called as congenital Coxavara, and there was some confusion regarding the these terms, congenital and developmental. It is usually diagnosed when the child begins to walk. The pathognomonic radiological sign is in the inferior part of the femoral neck. That is called as the Fairbanks sign. It is bilateral up to one half of the cases. In one half of the cases, it is unilateral. So this is the typical fragment that you are seeing here. In some cases, it may not be seen. In the opposite side, probably it is fused with the neck. This is an older child, around 5 or 6 year old. That's the Fairbanks sign. So congenital Coxavara, subtrochanteric, the progression always occurs. Developmental Coxavara is in the physis, the site of the deformity is in the physis, and may or may not progress. Rickets, it is in the physis and may progress unless the disease is controlled by drugs. Dysplasia, like fibrous dysplasia, in the metaphysis, and it usually progresses. In osteogenesis imperfecta also, it is in the metaphysis and it usually progresses. Sepsis, acquired Coxavara sepsis, it can be either in the physis or metaphysis, and progression occurs. Perthes disease also, it is in the epiphysis. Trauma, malunion of the fracture can also produce Coxavara, and it may partially resolve, but after malunion, it will not usually progress. And the incidence is 1 in 25,000. There is no racial predilection, equally seen in boys and girls. Ratio of unilateral to bilateral is 1:2. Bilateral cases, you always look for features of skeletal dysplasia. What are the clinical features? They manifest at the walking age group, usually with a painless limb, combination of true Trendelenburg and limb length inequalities. That is, a combination of short limb and a Trendelenburg gait may be present. But many of these children have the capacity to compensate for the shortening when they start walking with a tiptoe gait. So that is what is seen in this particular case. They will have easy fatigability and aching pain, and the waddling gait may be present in bilateral cases. In the general examination, you look for short stature, and especially the disproportionate short stature, that is a classical finding that is seen in skeletal dysplasia and evidence of metabolic bone disease. The classical clinical features are limitation of abduction and internal rotation, exaggeration of adduction and external rotation, positive Trendelenburg, and shortening. It produces various effects, Coxavara. One is the Trendelenburg gait. Why this occurs? Because there is a reduction in the neck shaft angle. There is a relative overgrowth of the greater trochanter, which is otherwise called as a trochanteric rocket. Hip abductor insertion to the greater trochanter moves higher. Therefore, the effective length is reduced. This leads to a weakening of the abductor liver arm and a Trendelenburg gait. Another problem is the femoral head retroversion. When there is a femoral head retroversion, the child will start walking with a outgoing gait. Moderate degree of retroversion in unilateral cases and more severe degrees of retroversion in bilateral cases need to be corrected. Then another problem that you see, you should look for before treating these children is look for acetabular dysplasia, because you are doing a valgus osteotomy to correct the Coxavara. And if there is an associated acetabular dysplasia, it causes uncovering of the femoral head. So you would like to do some acetabular procedure like a Degas osteotomy to correct that before doing a valgus osteotomy. Then limb length inequality, which is more significant in unilateral cases. And when there is a varus deformity in the hip, it produces a compensatory valgus deformity in the knee. So I have seen one or two cases where the child is coming with genuvalgum, and on examining the or taking an x-ray of the hip joint, you find that the problem is in the hip joint, that is a Coxavara. X-ray, I have already mentioned, decreased neck shaft angle, the triangular piece of bone or here that is called the Fairbanks sign. You always look for acetabular dysplasia, as you see in this particular case, and trochanteric overgrowth, which is often called as a trochanteric rocket. Then the measurements you have to take are the neck shaft angle, the head shaft angle, and the most important is the Weinstein's Hilgen-Rehner epiphyseal angle, which determine the prognosis of these children. If it is less, more than 60 degree, it always progresses. Below 45 degree, it often tend to correct spontaneously. In between, it may or may not progress, and you need to watch these children. The aim is to halt the progression, to improve the proximal femoral anatomy, and to correct limb length. You need three procedures. One is a subtrochanteric valgus osteotomy. Second, you have to reduce the overgrowth of the trochanter by trochanteric epiphyseodesis. And the third, if there is any limb length discrepancy, you need to correct this. How is it done? Usually a proximal femoral valgus osteotomy. There are several ways of doing that. You can use a plate. You can use a Lissaro fixator. You can use LRS. You can use JESS. And a greater trochanteric epiphyseodesis again can be done with the transphyseal screws, staple, or drilling the apophysis. And in older children, you need to transfer the greater trochanter to a distal level to increase the abductor length. And nowadays, very good plates are available for correcting these deformities. This is the plate that is designed by Synthes, the valgus osteotomy plate, which gives exact correction 230 degrees. So it's a very good implant for correcting these deformities. Thank you very much for the patient here.